Hello there. I'm just going to make this video because I feel led to do it. And this regards everybody. It involves everybody. I'll try and do it quickly. Try and keep it short, but there's a lot of information, so I'll speak fast. You can rewind and you can replay it back to yourself and go through it again if you need to. I'm walking in the cemetery at the moment with my cat. He likes me to take him for walks. So it's a nice, quiet, ideal time, no interruptions, to get this video put across. So here we go. We're information-based beings and we build our worldview upon the information that we get given. For the information to stand, it has to be truth. There's got to be one truth that stands through the whole of existence. There's a couple of worldviews, so to speak. Atheism, evolutionists, agnostics who think there must be something more to life than this, because, you know, there must be something more to it, and then creationists. So let's examine just the basics, basically, and see which stands as to be the truth, and then we'll have a look into that a little bit further. Atheism and evolutionists basically take God out of the picture right at the start. Evolutionists believe that there was a big bang in space, but they can't or won't say what caused it. There's three questions we need to ask ourselves to start off with. Where do we come from? What's our purpose? Why are we here? And where do you go when you die? So, if there was a big bang in space and there was nothing caused it, it was by accident, then what? And we come from space dust into bacteria, mud skippers, lizards, monkeys, us. What's your purpose? They can't say what caused it all, and everything we know is cause and effect. So they can't say what caused it all, and everything we know is intelligent design. So if it happened by accident, by nothing, they can't say what caused it all. They can't, and there's no explanation why you're here. If it happened by accident, well, what's your purpose? There isn't one. Where do you go when you die? Can't answer that either. So that's basically atheists and evolutionists. Let's humour the evolutionists just a little bit more. And I'm not having a go at atheists, I'm just looking at the ideology, the mindset behind it, the rational thinking. We have to examine it to see if it stands to be true. Where do we get our moral absolutes from? As in, like, where do we know what's right and wrong? How do we know what's right and wrong? Every tribe in the deepest, darkest jungle, they know murder's wrong, rape's wrong, stealing's wrong, thieving's wrong, adultery's wrong. You take something, if an atheist or an evolutionist takes something off, if you took something off an atheist, that doesn't belong to you, he isn't going to pat you on the back for it. He's going to say, hey, you're out of order. You've just stolen off me and stealing's wrong. So where do we get our moral absolutes from? If nothing caused it all to happen, we come from space dust, bacteria, mud skippers, lizards, monkeys and us, where do we get our moral absolutes from? They can't answer for that either. So let's look at creationism. Agnostics, they're sort of like thinking, there must be more to life than this, there must be some reason why it's all here. Well, we're getting around to that. Let's look at creationism. The very first verse of the Bible, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, time, that is time, past, present, future. In the beginning, time, past, present, future, God created the heavens, that's space, height, depth, width. In the beginning, time, past, present, future, God created the heavens, space, height, depth, width, and the earth. Earth is matter, solid, gas, liquid. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created space, time, and matter. space, time, matter. Where would you put the matter if you didn't have the space, and when would you put it if you didn't have the time? Right, all the scientists even accept now, and they agree now, that space, time, matter all had a beginning. So that's the very first verse of the Bible. God created space, he created time, and he created matter. He's not limited by space, time, and matter. He's not limited by his creation. If he was, he wouldn't be God. We are in a thing called time. Everything has a beginning and an end. We, us in our 3-pound carnal mind, we only understand things starting and ending. Life, basically, so everything is born and then it dies. It buds and it dies, right? So we're in a thing called time. Now, the evolutionists, right, if you were to look at Darwinian evolution, where it says everything evolves, show me one evidence of Darwinian evolution where a species changes into another species. There isn't any. It doesn't exist. The oldest layer of fossils, the Cambrian layer, they call it the Cambrian explosion. If evolution was true, then they looked at the oldest layer of fossils and then come all right up to the present day. It should read like a flick book of transitional fossils. All these animals and creatures all transitioning, changing. Now they say, the evolutionists say, Darwinian evolution takes millions of years. You've probably heard that. They teach it in schools. Now that goes against the second law of thermodynamics, because the second law of thermodynamics says everything winds down, everything gets weaker, it doesn't get stronger. A tree will eventually rot and fall over. A building will crumble to nothing in a couple of hundred years. Our bodies age and die. So their theory, they can't tell you what caused it all, and we know everything is intelligent design. They can't give you a reason why you're even here, so life's flipping hopeless. Quite depressing. They can't tell you when you go, when you die, which is an elephant in the room. We all, death is hanging over our heads, and we want to know what happens when we die. So they can't answer for that either. They can't answer for where we get our moral absolutes from, and there's no evidence of Darwinian evolution where a species changes into another species. Not one. And going on top of that, scientists in America stumbled across soft tissue on a dinosaur bone, and she said, we know this can't be 65 plus million years old. So obviously she was in the mindset of an evolutionist. She says, we know this can't be 65 plus million years old. We know this can't even be 1 million years old. We're going to put a maximum of 20,000 years on it. A maximum, which pulls the timeline narrative right back down to a biblical timeline, a biblical narrative of a young Earth, 6 to 7,000 years. So, because every day of creation is a prophetic to 1,000 years. So there we go. There's just a few basics of major errors in their theories. Atheists, evolutionists. So here we are, creationists. Right? God created. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Space, time, matter. Very first verse of the Bible. Where would you put the matter if you didn't have the space? When would you put it if you didn't have the time? A trinity of trinities. Very first verse of the Bible. Right? So God created. Where do we get our moral absolutes from? God says, I put my law on your heart. You know what's right and wrong. You've got a conscience. Conscience means with knowledge. Con means with. Science means knowledge. So you intuitively, instinctively know what's right and wrong because God put his law on our heart. Now, so God put his law on our heart, we know what's right and wrong. We've got a conscience. If you were to ask somebody if they were a good person, well, a lot of people say, yeah. The top definition of the word good in the dictionary is moral excellence. God's got a thing called the moral law, the Ten Commandments. This is God's moral law, this is God's standard, the Ten Commandments. And when you hold the Ten Commandments up as a mirror and see how you measure up, we'll see how good that we really are as human beings. One of them is, how many lies have you told in your life? Too many to count. One of them is, do not steal. Too many to count. One of them is, Jesus says, you've heard about not committing adultery. He says, but I tell you, even if you look with lust, you commit adultery in your heart. Too many to count. How many people blaspheme God's name this day and age? That's punishable by death in the Old Testament. Now think of this. Why do people blaspheme and use Jesus' name and nobody else's? They all use the name of Jesus Christ. They pull God's holy name down and use it as a foul letter filth word or a word of disgust. Now, Jesus is the only one that's ever walked this planet that's never sinned, never did anything wrong. So why would they use his name and nobody else's? Not Hitler, Stalin, Pol Pot, Jack the Ripper, anybody evil. They use one holy name. Now, the Bible says the carnal mind is in enmity to God without reason. We are born into sin. We are slaves to sin. This is what the Bible says. A two-year-old will naturally lie. The parent ain't told it to lie and taught it to lie. It will naturally lie. Who's been in the biscuit jar? Not me. You know what I mean? So it'll naturally lie. And as we get older, our sins just get bigger and bigger and greater and greater, committing more crimes against our Creator. Now, the Bible tells you what death is. It says it's wages. The wages of sin is death. God hates sin so much that there's a death penalty for it. There's a punishment. When Adam and Eve, hang on, before we get to that. So we know what caused it all, what created it all. God created us in his image, moral beings. What's our purpose? Why we're here? In the book of John, Nicodemus, a religious leader, came up to Jesus in secret. He says, what have I got to do to inherit the kingdom of God? Jesus said, I'll tell you the truth, unless you're born again, you'll not see the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus says, well, can a man get back into his mother's womb and be born a second time? Jesus says, I'll tell you the truth, you're born of the flesh, but unless you're born of the spirit and water, you will not see the kingdom of heaven. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Unless you're born of the spirit, you'll not see the kingdom of heaven. The Holy Spirit. Now, when Adam and Eve were walking with God in the Garden of Eden, and Lucifer deceived them to question God's word, and that's where everything goes wrong. The devil gets everybody to question the truth. God's word is truth. So he gets them to question the truth and then go down another road. And that's what leads to danger and trouble. So Jesus says, unless you're born of the Holy Spirit, when Adam and Eve were walking in the Garden of Eden, Lucifer deceived them to go against God's word. They ate off the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God says you can eat off every tree, but don't eat off the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you do, you will surely die. So Lucifer deceived them to go against God's word. He says, did he really say that? And then they ate off the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's why we experience good and evil in this world. And none of us like the evil parts, do we? None of us like anything bad happening. We just want all the good. But that's why we know good and evil, because Adam and Eve ate off the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's why we know it. We don't like it. So when they did that and they rebelled against God, they sinned against God, they were spiritually cut off. Everybody born since Adam and Eve are born spiritually dead, spiritual stillbirths. We have no desire to have a relationship with our heavenly God Creator. And this is why Jesus is saying you need to be born again. The Bible says we're slaves to sin, we're born into sin, we will naturally sin, but we have to be, so we need the Holy Spirit, which overrides our sinful nature and causes, breaks the chains and fetters of sin. So it breaks those chains that bound us to sin, because we were slaves to sin, and it breaks them and it frees us. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. That's what the Bible says about the Holy Spirit. Greater is the Holy Spirit in me than he that is in the world. So it breaks the chains of fetters. Now we have the ability, because that's been born again by the Spirit of God. We are God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He made man in his image. We are body, soul and spirit, right? So Jesus is the body, the soul, the mind is God, and the spirit, our spirit, the Holy Spirit, right? We're spiritual, but our spirits are dead, so we need God's Holy Spirit. We need to get back what was lost at the Garden of Eden. We need to get God's Holy Spirit back again, and that's been born again. And the Holy Spirit overrides your sinful nature. Now you have the ability to turn from sin and please your Heavenly Father, God Creator, and have a relationship with him. That's what he wants that relationship. So that's why we're here, right? To be born again by God's Spirit. Realize you're a sinner. Look at God's moral law, the Ten Commandments. Hold them up as a mirror. See how you measure up. Failed miserably, right? So you need a saviour, right? Now, if God is a judge, if you're to die without Christ as your saviour, this is why Jesus came into the world, to beat sin and death, right? Because he was perfect. It only takes somebody sinless to be able to beat sin and death, right? And that's why God saw the sacrifice was perfect and he rose him from the dead 3 days later, according to the scriptures, right? So that's our purpose, to be born again. That's when you step from darkness into light. That's when you become a child of God. If you were to die without Christ as your saviour, excuse me, if you were to die with Christ, without Christ being your saviour, it's like being in a courtroom. You'll stand in front of the judge of the universe, which is God, and you'll read up your rap sheet, right? All these crimes, somebody has to pay the fine. Somebody has to do the sentence for these crimes. And this is what death is. This is eternally cut off from God, and you don't want to be there, right? So if you're standing in court and Jesus is your saviour, when you die, God will, you'll stand in front of God. God will recognise you as one of his children anyway, because he's given you the Holy Spirit. He'll see you washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, forgiven for all your sin. And he'll know you because you'll have a relationship with him, right? There's those people that God will turn around and say, go away, I don't know you, because they have no relationship with him. So he doesn't know them. And they'll go and be eternally cut off from God. So when you stand in front of God, who's paid your fine? Well, Jesus has paid my fine. You're saved by grace through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. All other religions in the world are works-based religions. They're trying to do something to get into heaven. They're trying to make the good outweigh the bad. Nothing you can do. It's a free gift of salvation. Free gift of eternal life. That is God's grace. That is God's love. That Jesus paid your penalty. He took it on the cross, right? Jesus, it says, while you were a sinner, Christ died for you. God wasn't waiting for you to get perfect, because you can't. You have to have the Holy Spirit. You have to believe in Jesus Christ, that he died on a cross and he paid your punishment for you. He paid everybody's punishment for them. It's a free gift, and it's there for everybody. All you got to do is believe it and accept it, receive it, repent for your sin, be sorry for what you've done, and realize it was all put onto Jesus Christ. You do that, all who call on the name of Jesus will be saved. That's what the Bible says. All who call on the name of Jesus with a contrite heart, genuine from the heart. It's not head knowledge. It's not how much Bible you know. It's not how clever you are. It's not because you've got a big salary coming in. It's not anything like that. It's not about your status in this world. It's about God sees your heart, right? He sees your heart. It's not about head knowledge. It's not about how much Bible you know. So you just look up, believe, and just say, Jesus, save me. All who call on the name of Jesus will be saved. Believe that he died and he paid the penalty for your sin, right? And all you do, and then God will give you the Holy Spirit. And then you'll start having a relationship with God. Then you'll want to please God. You'll want to serve God because of what he's done for you. And that is being born again by the Spirit of God. And then you're saved unto good works. You're not saved by works, because all the religions in the world, right? Roman Catholicism, Mormonism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jehovah's Witnesses, all of them, right? All these other religions in the world are works-based religions. They're trying to buy their way into heaven. They're trying to do something to get them into heaven. Thief on the cross never had no time to do nothing. He recognised Jesus for who he was, and Jesus says, today you will be me in paradise. Right? So there you go. That's your purpose. Where do we come from? God created us in his image, moral beings. We've broken God's moral law many times over. Somebody has to pay the fine. Somebody has to pay the price for those sins committed against God. Jesus did it. You believe in Jesus Christ and you're born again. God gives you the Holy Spirit. That breaks the chains of fetters of sin. Now you're free from sin to please God. And God will do it by his Spirit. He says, by my Spirit, I'll complete and perfect the work I've begun in you. Right? So where do you go when you die? Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Job done. So where do we come from? What's your purpose? Where do you go when you die? God created us in his image, moral beings. What's your purpose? To be born again. Have the Spirit of God living inside you, so then you can walk in the Spirit. Right? The Bible tells you, don't walk in the flesh. Everybody's walking in the flesh. Right? They're going on, your flesh is all about your feelings. I'm going to go and get a holiday to make myself feel good. I'm going to buy some new trainers to make myself feel good. I'll get a new car. Make myself feel good. I'm going to sleep with this person. Make myself feel good. I'm going to do drugs. Make myself feel good. That's all living in the flesh. And it all leads to sin. Right, your flesh is up and down, your feelings are up and down, right? But when you're walking in the Spirit, which is righteousness, peace and joy, you're forgiven for your sin. God wipes them from, he says, I'll cast them as far as the east is from the west. God will wipe the slate clean, put his Holy Spirit inside you. Now you've got an ability, right? Now you've got God's strength inside you, his Spirit inside you. You can walk, you don't want to do sin. God wants you to hate sin. He wants you to hate sin as much as he hates sin. And you'll look back and go, I don't want to do any of that anymore. I don't want to do that, and your life will change. And that's the power of God within you, right? So that's your purpose, to be born again. So we can get into eternal life with heaven, all eternity, right? We're all passing through. We're all passing through. None of us likes the evil stuff, right? The world is absolutely going off a cliff fast. Everything that's happening in the world today is all written in the Bible. Everything is prophetic. The Bible is past, present and future, all in one book. And when you're reading end time eschatology, when you're looking at the end times, right, and seeing what God says, this is lamb, that lamb, that lamb, that lamb, that lamb, right, you're reading it and you're looking into the world and you think, look, it's all happening. Why? Because we're in the end times. We're in the end times. The Pope is just setting up the one world religion up in Abu Dhabi called Chrislam. That's a multi. That's multi. Multi-faith religion that is just, it's just been confirmed a few weeks ago, right? That's the one world religion that the Bible speaks of in the end times. The going cashless society, right? It speaks of that in the end times, and the mark of the beast, which will be something, a mark in the back of the right hand or the forehead. You can't buy a soul without it. A bloke in England, right, has just been the first one to take a chip in the back of his hand. Half of Sweden have been using it for ages anyway, right? The technology's already here, right? Everything's moving cashless, right? So, and they want you to be, and then Yuval Noah Harari, the Klaus Schwab, the leader of the World Economic Forum, his advisor, Yuval Noah Harari, a homosexual Jew, how far from God can you get, right? He says, you're not a mysterious soul anymore. He says, you're a hackable animal. That's what he said. That's just making people transhumanism. Satan wants to corrupt everything that God's done, you see. So they want to put chips in people and make them robots. Well, I don't know how far down the line that'll go. But when you take that mark of the beast, you're irredeemable. God will say, you've worshipped Satan, you're worshipping his number, you're worshipping the beast system, and you're irredeemable. You're not going to have your name written on the book of life, no matter what you do. You take that, that's it, you're irredeemable. You're lost for all eternity. And this is where they're moving, this is where they're going. So this is an urgent message to everybody who can come across this. If you come across it, share it. I'm doing this for, I ain't got a channel as such, you know what I mean, like YouTubers do. I'm just putting this out there. So this is a message, this is the truth. Know the truth, the truth shall make you free. There's so much more I could say about all sorts, but like, send questions and I'll answer you. But you need to know the truth. This is what all this is about. Where do we come from? God created us in his image, moral beings. We've broken God's moral law many times over. That's the Ten Commandments. Hold them up and use them as a mirror. See how you measure up, right? We fail miserably. We absolutely fail miserably many times over, right? So we've committed crimes against our creator. Evolutionists and atheists can't answer for what caused it all. Something happened in space, a big bang. Well, what caused it all? Everything is intelligent design. Everything is cause and effect. It has to have a purpose. Oh, no, because they don't want to admit the truth. They don't want to admit that God exists. Jesus never lied. So let's listen to Jesus. Never mind your corrupt politicians, your BBC propaganda, everybody's propaganda on the TV. That's all propaganda, right? The Bible says the God of this world is Satan. The Bible's telling you the God of this world is Satan. So if Satan's at the top, you've got a hierarchy, a pyramid of power. Satan's at the top. And there's 13 bloodline families, Rothschilds, Rockefellers, the Bilderberg Group, all those lot, secret societies, 322, Skull and Bones, Bohemia Grove, all these lot, and all these world leaders are all tied up with it. And it's all Satan, Freemasonry. It's all Satanism at the top. It's all worshipping Satan. And the God of this world is Satan. So these people haven't got your best interest at heart. The only people who've got your best interest at heart is God. Jesus and everybody who's following him, because they're the one who's telling people the truth. Know the truth shall make you free. So there you go. Where do we come from? God created us in his image. What's your purpose? Be born again. Believe that Jesus paid all your sins. He paid the fine, he paid the crimes, he took the punishment. Everything was put onto him, and he paid the fine because he loves. It's love. It's love. We have free will. For free will to exist, for love to exist, you have to have free will. Otherwise, you're robots. God didn't want to create robots. He wanted you to love him. He wanted you to free. You can't grab a woman or a bloke and say, you're going to be my spouse and you're going to love me. That's not free will, right? God wants you to turn your will and put it in line with his. He wants you to love him, right? He wants you to freely love him, right? So that's why for love to exist, you have to have free will. But there's a risk with free will. When Adam and Eve were walking with God, they didn't need to know sin and death, good and evil. They didn't need to know the difference between good and evil. They were already walking in absolute harmonious beauty, right? Everything, because they were in God's will. Sin hadn't come into the world, So the only way they could use their free will is to turn from being in God's will and to commit a crime against God, to pick a sin. And that's what people do when they're using their free will. They're using their free will to be out of God's will, right? It's time to get your will in line with God's will. Walk in righteousness, peace and joy. When people are going and buying holidays to try and make themselves feel good, they're drinking, they're partying, trying to make themselves feel good, they're sleeping around, looking at pornography, doing drugs, whatever it is, they're telling themselves they're feeling good. They know they aren't feeling good. They're sticking up. That's the flesh man, the flesh man. Just don't listen to the flesh man. The God wants to, he says, die to the flesh. Die to the flesh man. Your sinful nature is your flesh man. Your sinful nature loves the sex, drugs and rock and roll and bigger car, bigger telly, more money, drinking, partying and all that rubbish. That's worldly. That's in the natural world, right? The natural realm, right? God says, you're in the world, but you're not of the world. Don't be conformed to the world. Have your mind, keep your mind on things above, not on things below. In other words, don't love anything in this world. Keep your mind on your eternity. You may live 70 years old. You may live to 120. You're still passing through. You can't take any of that with you. And you've committed crimes against God, you're still going to stand in front of your Creator and give an account. So that's the message. That's the truth. That is the truth. God created you in His image, moral beings. You've broken God's law, moral law many times over. You know that. Your conscience testifies against you, right? You know that. You know you've lied, you've stolen, you've cheated, you've looked with lust, that's committing adultery. If you hate a brother, you've committed murder in your heart. If you look with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. Blaspheme God's name. I mean, you've done at least one of those many times over, at least, right? So when sin came in, when death came into the world, is because of sin, right? God hates sin so much, there's a death penalty for it. So even if you were born, you lied once, or you looked with lust once, or you've stolen once, there's a death penalty for it, right? Because it's sin. Sin can't be into heaven, right? Sin, God's not going to allow sin into heaven, or any criminal into heaven, right? You're saved by grace through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. You can't make your good outweigh your bad, right? You can't buy your way into heaven. Jesus paid the fine on the cross. That's the whole reason he came, right? The Jews were reading the Old Testament. The Old Testament had 300 prophecies in it, speaking about this Messiah coming, right? Jesus fulfilled all 300 Old Testament prophecies. A mathematician worked it out for a man to fulfill just 8 of those prophecies is a billion to one. The Bible says all scripture is God-breathed, right? It's inspired by the Holy Spirit through godly men, right? So there was godly men, the Holy Spirit inspired these godly men to write all these things. And it's prophecy, right? It's all prophecy, right, of what's going to happen. And it's 100% accurate. The Old Testament, 300 Old Testament prophecies about Jesus, this Messiah coming, right? And Jesus fulfilled all the Old Testament prophecies. Why? Because in the book of John it says, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God, the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. It also says that there was nothing that wasn't created through that Jesus didn't speak into creation. So if it's the Holy Spirit, so if God's Word is inspired by the Holy Spirit, God, Jesus, stepped into His own Word. That's why He could fulfill all the Old Testament prophecies to that degree. It's impossible for any man to do it, normal man. See, Jesus is God, you see? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, right? So there you go. So that's why he could fulfill all these Old Testament prophecies. So the Jews who were reading the Old Testament, right, or the Torah, right, and the Old Testament, were reading about this Messiah coming. So they were waiting for this Messiah, but they expected the Messiah to be a military leader that was going to come and take them away from the oppressions of the Romans because we were under Roman rule. When he was a humble carpenter, son with 12 scruffy blokes, didn't fit their narrative. You know what I mean? Even though he fulfilled all the Old Testament prophecies, they got it done for blasphemy, claiming to be God when he said, I am, right? They knew what I am meant, because when Moses was talking to God through the burning bush, God was talking to Moses, right, through the burning bush. Moses says, who do I go back and tell him that was talking to? And he says, I am. So they knew I am meant God, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Trinity, right? So there you go. I think I've covered it all. Yeah, and Jesus never lied. And Jesus prophesied for the future, right? He fulfilled the Old Testament. He completed the Old Testament, fulfilled it. Now, those Jews who didn't believe Jesus was the Messiah, they put him on the cross. There was many Jews that came to Christ and were born again, became Christians. Romans wrote about Jesus. The Greeks wrote about Jesus. They all say, Flavius Josephus, first AD Jewish historian, wrote about Jesus. They all say he died on a cross. Did he rise on the third day? There was over 500 people that had seen him in one go. Right? After the resurrection, in bodily form. Witnesses, tons of them. They didn't tell you at school when they tell you the nativity play, right? They don't say, oh, when he rose from the dead, he actually stayed around for 40 days in the flesh. They don't tell you that at school. And Saul, who became Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, right? He was Saul. He was a Jewish leader, right? A Pharisee, and he was going around killing Christians because he was thinking he's doing God a favor. He was one of those that didn't believe Jesus was God, Jesus was the Messiah, right? So he was going around killing Christians. He was good at it, and he enjoyed it, and they feared him, right? But on the road to Damascus, Jesus appeared to him after the resurrection. Jesus appeared to him. This is why Saul, why are you persecuting my church? Saul did a 180, became Paul. Wrote no notes and what a witness to have in court. The biggest persecutor, he could, because Paul says, I'm the worst of sinners, right? I'm the worst of sinners. So he calls him the worst of sinners. So how many Christians has he killed, right? He says, I'm the worst of sinners. But now, he wrote most of the New Testament because of what he's saying. Eyewitness accounts. People slaver a load of rubbish about the Bible. Oh, there's no, it's all just a book of stories. Oh, it's just this, that, and the other, blah, 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 blah. Eyewitness accounts. John. Saul. Over 500. They all went to horrible deaths as well. The disciples went to horrible, the apostles went to horrible deaths. A lot of them faced horrible deaths, torture. Why? What, on a lie? No. Because Jesus rose from the dead. All your sin was put on, all our sins were put onto Jesus Christ. He paid the fine because he was perfect and sinless. God saw that sacrifice was perfect and acceptable, rose him from the dead. Beating sin and death. That's what he came to do, beat sin and death. Why? So then we can have eternal life. That's the truth. Play this back. Go through it again. Share it with your friends. Everybody, we are information-based beings, and we're building our worldview upon what information that we get. But it has to be truth to stand. Nothing can stand again. Nothing. If you believe in something, right? And God resists the proud, but shows grace and mercy to the humble, right? You have to have a humble. You have to be humble. You can't be proud and arrogant. Pride and arrogance comes from Satan, right? We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. There's not one that's good, not one. So don't call yourself a good person. That's self-righteousness, right? None of us are righteous, right? We're all sinners, but we can be saved by grace. God's grace. You're saved by grace through faith. Faith that Jesus died and paid the price for you, died on a cross and rose on the third day. You're saved by grace, God's grace, through faith in Jesus Christ, not by works, lest any man should boast. God bless you all. I'll see you in heaven.